Let's have the introduction first. Let me start with me. So my name is Sunny, and I am your trainer for this MD-100 Windows client training. So over here, during my tenure in Koenig Solutions, I have been delivering multiple technologies, starting with Microsoft. So I deliver Windows MD-100 and also MD-101, which is managing modern desktop, along with some Azure administration trainings. Apart from that, I also deliver trainings on Red Hat, SUSE, and LPI Linux courses. Not only that, I also deliver trainings in shell programming, which would be PowerShell, Bash Shell, Python, and Perl scripting languages. So here we are today on working on MD-100 training. That is pretty much about me. So this is the course we are going to discuss in this training, MD-100 Windows 10 Client. Right. We are already been to the introduction. So thank you for joining us today. This training is officially provided by Microsoft, and we are the training partners. Regarding this course, that what this course is about, well, all these things you can read from here, but I would like to point out one major thing. This course emphasizes on Windows 10 as well as Windows 11, unless otherwise stated, that is case over here, but it majorly focuses on 10 as well as 11. Previously, this course was for Windows 10 only. You will find many of the images over here working for Windows 10, also for Windows 11, because you can choose to work with either of the ones. This training supports for both of the systems. Some prerequisite, well, certain things are listed over here, but in my opinion, you don't need any prerequisite. Even if you're not aware of this, anything with this course, anything regarding Windows, that is again totally fine with us. Certain technical definitions we might be required to know, that is one case, but to work with and to use, that's not a problem. Course agenda. In this training, we are going to have 11 modules, starting from the installation of the Windows client machine to the troubleshooting hardware and drivers. There are multiple modules that we are going to discuss related to pretty much everything on the Windows client side. So these are the topics: install of the Windows client, configuring of the authorization and authentications, also about the post-installation configurations and personalization, regarding networking and client configuration, storage, configuration of the data access and its usage, managing some applications in Windows environment, configuring the threat protection, supporting the Windows client environment, taking support of that, and then regarding the troubleshooting some applications and drivers. That is what this course is about. That's what we are going to learn in this one. Regarding the course handbook, so except Martin, all you guys have redeemed that book, and that is found on the skill pipe, right? So that is your course handbook. Regarding your labs, that also environment we have seen how to work with that. I'll just explain it to you, but there is also the lab environment that has been provided to you, where you would be able to work with the guided exercises of each of the module that we are going to discuss over here. So to start off with this training, let me start off with our first module. That would be about installing the Windows client environment. To conduct this, I will be using PPTs over here, provided by the official Microsoft, to use that in our training environments. So in this first task, first module, we are going to work on the topics, that is exploring the Windows client, examining Windows client additions and requirements, evaluating Windows client installation methods, upgrading and migrating Windows client, and evaluating the deployment methods. Over the times, there are many changes being done into the technical environments, labs, as well as with the training materials. So many of these things are like switched, some are being removed, some are being added. So here's starting off with our first part, that is exploring the Windows client environment, right? That is lesson one. In this one, we are going to understand about the Windows client, what's new in this, exploring some benefits of Windows client towards small and medium-sized organizations, and explaining desktop management in an enterprise environment. So this is what the first chapter is about over here. Now, if you say, what is Windows client, right? Can anyone explain over here what in your terms is Windows client? Anyone? Okay, all right. So suppose if we talk about Windows client, first of all, Windows, that's an operating system we have got over here. And to this environment, right, what makes it usable? What makes it workable? The factors that it has multiple users that can sign in and work in the environment. We can make use of this system to perform some operations, run or execute some applications, and drive some performance of different applications over here. Right. Such is the use case, or such is our Windows client, where we can connect, communicate, and perform some operations. So let's discuss what all these things are. So describing the Windows client, multiple form factors and hardware, as we just discussed, that it can run on multiple hardwares, it can work with multiple use cases, like of the users' applications, and making and using these applications to perform some operations. Seamless transition for users of multiple devices. You can use a single account on one of the system and use the same account on another system, and you can easily switch your system, your environment, from one system to another system. Focus on cloud service integrations. Not only that, you can use it or install it in your environment and then work with it, but you can also use it directly through the cloud service as well. Enhancements delivered through regular continuous updates. So as we know that Windows provides us with the regular updates, we can use that for continuous enhanced deliveries. Easy to implement updates and upgrades. We don't have to do much. Simply accept the updates and start by clicking on the updates tab on the Windows update bar. And without much of your manual task, it can start upgrading or updating your system. That easy to work on Windows client environment. So this was some references being provided to what your Windows client environment is. What is new in the Windows client? So if you talk about Windows 10 specifically, so in Windows 10, Windows as a service is now being implemented, supporting for multiple device types, some improved cloud integration, MDM management, and support for bring your own device for your organizations, and the policies that also are being added related to that. New and enhanced recovery tools and options, client Hyper-V and Windows Sandbox. These applications also being included and being used now. Broadband and VPN enhancements and security enhancements. Those were the improvements to Windows 10. Now, what are the improvements to Windows 11? We are getting a new start screen, multiple UI enhancements, Snap layouts and snap groups have been now added. Widgets as another column right now has been introduced to Windows 11. New Microsoft Store and support for Android application as well. That's what is new to now Windows 11. These are some references to that what is new to the devices over here. Evaluating the benefits of Windows Client for small and medium sized organization. So there are many reasons for small and medium sized organization to consider Windows 10 or 11 because it is easier to use, provides you with continuous updates, has improved device management, also supporting for bring your own device. You don't no longer have to rely with your organization system. You can also use your own system, and depending on the company's policy, you can directly sign in with your work account over here. Distributions of applications by using the Microsoft Store for Business, and it is more secure now. So such are the benefits of using Windows Client Environment to your small and mid-sized organizations. Explain desktop management in an enterprise environment. It has a simplified deployment. We know that a Windows environment can be installed in various ways. It's not only one. We can directly use a bootable file, or we can create a network boot file and then we can download it into the system to install, or we can just simply or use the an ISO file, installed ISO file to copy in on another system to directly boot into the environment. There are various ways to do that. So simplified deployment of new and replacement computers. There is traditional imaging or working with the MDM configuration policies. Consistent applications and hardware across the organizations. Same things are being used overall. And simplified inventory, depending on what all you need in your system, and simpler software deployment. If you're choosing to go with cloud integration of your system, then that is even more easy to work with. You can just define what all things you need in your environment, and just by adding or signing into with that username will fetch or synchronize everything to your physical system. So that is based on how you are choosing to enhance or to use your client environment. Here is one picture that has been defined right side of this one. Create a Windows PE media. That is about the environment in which you are using a bootable file, the ISO file as a booted file, and then using it to install in your system. You can either provide all these applications right in this place, or you can maybe upgrade later. For that, you can create an answer file that supports or that answers to the questions that you require in your system. Deploy the image with the answer file to reference computer wherever you are using it. That's what all it would have once you are installing it into your system. Right, run the sysprep command on the reference computer, use the image, and then we can directly deploy the image to the target computer. That easy to work with, just based on this PE media file. This is how we can install it into the environment. Guys, if any of the times you do have any queries while we are discussing all these things, you can just either raise your hand, or you can just unmute yourself and ask me right in that place. Okay. All right, moving further. Some knowledge check and summary to what we have just discussed. So in all these points, we are discussing about that when we are working with the Windows 10 or 11 environment, the supports the enhanced environment that has been described, do they meet our requirement? Are they being used according to the organization that we are working with? Whether or not they support and they are easy to work with, right? Like considering the fact that it has now more secure environment being provided, it has support to client Hyper-V as well. Previously, it was supporting working with the server only. Now we can directly run it on client also, right? So all such features, what and how also now that we see in Windows 10, we are getting the Wi-Fi hotspot. Depending on the Wi-Fi that you're connected to, you can create a hotspot out of that. So all these things we see that now are being useful to us that were introduced to either Windows 11, if that's what you're using, or Windows 10 that were they were introduced to. So this is what these different questions over here are giving the answers to. Moving further in lesson number 2, that is about examine Windows client additions and requirements. Over here, we are going to discuss about some client addition and capabilities of Windows client environment. Selecting a Windows client addition that which would support our organization better, and examining the Windows hardware requirements. Because if you have to install an operating system on the environment of our organization, which hardware would it need? Because you know that Windows 11 cannot be just installed on any system. It requires specifically DPM version 2. It cannot be installed on DPM version 1. So some limitations over there. So depending and checking the hardware requirements that at least what we need to install that, working on a Windows 10 environment, if we say, it takes near about 800 MB of memory just to install and work with the Windows 10 environment. That much memory it takes and is being used by your graphics, right? So we need to use more memory than that if we have to support more of our applications to work with. So it requires at least 2 GB of memory to work with, or smoothly 4 GB. So we'll talk about all these things over here. So first of all, starting with the examine Windows client additions and capabilities. So we know that there are different client additions depending on what they can be used for, or whether or not they would meet our requirements to work with. These are defined over here. If you're talking about the home edition, it is for individual or home use only and is available to everyone. Windows Pro is available for small and medium-sized businesses or advanced users. Although it is available for everyone, but specific consumers would be them. If you're going for enterprise E3 and E5, that consumer for those is large enterprises, but that is available only to volume licensing customers. Those have used and purchased volume license. LTSC, again, for the same case, for large enterprises having volume license. Pro Education is for school staff, administrators, teachers, and students. And it is available to academic volume licensing. Education is for, again, with the school staff, administrators, teachers, and students. And that is, again, provided through academic volume licensing. IoT. That is for fixed purpose devices, depending on the device hardware we are going to work with, and is available to IoT distributors. So these are some of the additions that are described over here to who they are actually created for and whether or not how those things would be available to them. That is about it. Moving on to the next part, which says selecting a Windows client edition. What factors would you decide, would you consider to choose the edition to select? Form factors could be whether or not you require a desktop or laptop to work with, or tablet or hybrid laptop and tablet, right? or Xbox, HoloLens, Surface Hub. These could be the factors that can help you decide which client edition can you choose. What would be its functionality? Either it is used for end users or as a kiosk or shared machine or as a server machine, right? What would be the management and infrastructure requirements? Where are you going to use it? To work for some applications or to do what? What would be its capabilities? Whether or not you're choosing to go with 32-bit or 64-bit. Although Microsoft, specifically for this course, enhances on 64-bit, but works with 32-bit as well, wherever required. So you can choose which operating system architecture would you like to have for your edition to be used or to be chosen. Depending on that, what would be the hardware requirements? If you're choosing to go for Windows 10, the minimum requirements are processor of 1 gigahertz or faster, RAM at least 2 GB, right? Hard disk requires at least 620 GB to work with. Graphic card requires DirectX version 9 or with WDDM. Display of about 800 by 600 in size. These are the minimum requirements. To move on to the Windows 11 minimum requirements, requires at least 1 gigahertz of processor or faster or SoC. RAM requires 4 GB now. So that just enhances to 2 more GB over here to work with Windows 11. It requires DirectX 12 and WDDM of 2.0. 10 is working with 1.0 as well. Display requires 720 pixel or 9 inch or greater monitor that is having 8 bits per color. UEFI and secure boot capability is now mandatory along with PPM module 2.0 to work with. Right. So that is some minimum requirements just to have or install Windows 11 on your hardware. Some feature-specific requirements that if you require to work with Windows Hello operation, the feature provided by Windows 10 and 11, you require biometric feature on your hardware. If you're going for BitLocker, that it requires a password, a TPM, or a USB flash drive for your password. For a client Hyper-V, you require 64-bit system with SL80 capabilities and additional of 2 GB of RAM. If you're using BitLocker to go, that specifically works with the flash drives, so you will require that. For direct storage, you will require NVMe SSD storage now, not HDD. So these are some feature-specific requirements that you will be required to have depending on choosing of your Windows 10 environment or maybe Windows 11 environment. That is some references to them. Until this point, do any of you have any queries or questions in this place? Okay. So what we have learned until this point, that if we are working on our Windows system, to install it, what factors, what things do we require to learn or to understand about to meet our requirements? That if I'm choosing this, what all things I would need first of all to work with that? Right. So we need to consider all these things over here. And well, that's what we have discussed in these points over here. Moving further now in our lesson number 3, that is regarding the evaluation of Windows client installation methods. Now that we are ready with our edition, that which edition would we choose and on which hardware are we going to install that, now regarding the installation part. In this, we are going to discuss about the installation methods, some checking of the process of these installation, and choosing to work with the new deployment options. Starting with our first part, that is exploring Windows client installation methods. Some traditional methods that were to work with the setup.exe, in which you would just use your ISO in your system from your device, from USB device or CD drive, and just directly start install. Obviously, that was required to be booted first. Or go with the wipe and load, simply clean out everything, and using the internet, you can just directly download your ISO, your operating system on your system. But first, you will have to sign in to the environment. So these were the traditional methods. Now, we have modern methods. We have in-place upgrade. That means on the same machine, upgrading to a new system. Windows 10 to Windows 11, you don't need to change your system. If it meets the requirement, you can directly upgrade it. Reconfiguration, depending on the system's requirement or the user requirement, we can reconfigure the Windows environment. We can change the Windows additions as well, depending on the keys if we have to that. Provisioning also, using the snapshots, we can also upgrade or degrade depending on the requirements, or upgrade through updates. That is the best use case over here, that we don't have to do much. Simply, we can upgrade using the updates provided in the system. So these are the options we are getting in this place to upgrade our system. What are the installation methods that we can choose? We can choose either of the traditional ones or the modern methods over here. Regarding the all these methods that we have just discussed also, in-place upgrade. So that is nothing but just moving from the system to a new system. That also works with the migration pretty much, but that would use the same machine over there, and you are just enhancing some capabilities of your environment. New deployment, well, that is just like out-of-the-box experience in which you are getting a new system, having all those new hardware as well as the software, that is the operating system within that. Refreshing is just like resetting everything and reinstalling again from fresh, from scratch. That is refreshing. Provisioning is just like creating an answer list and checking what all you need, creating the snapshots out of that, and then removing whatever you don't need from your system or adding whatever you need. Migration is just like moving from one system, one hardware, to a totally new system. That would be migrating over here. So these are the different installation methods that we get while working with all these Windows client environment options, that how we are choosing to install our system with, in which what different ways. This is the setup.exe one that we just talked about, that how it used to go with the traditional way of installing our environment, in which we were using a boot device, booting environment, and we would just switch into the hardware and open it, boot it with the F12 depending on the hardware, and we will get these options over there. So that is the process of installing the Windows client environment. Some new deployment options. Brian, do you have any query? So, moving further, evaluating the new deployment options. So, what we have seen in this place, first of all, we have seen which system, which edition of our operating system would we require, depending on what the use case is. What purpose would it serve? What on which device are we going to use that? Whatever that device is, whether or not it would support that particular edition we are choosing. And if we're going with that, whether or not we have the licensing and everything, whatever it requires. Who's going to manage that? How many systems or how many different systems would we require it on to be installed? What would be the network connectivity and capacity to use What would be the features of the operating system are we going to use? What applications would it contain? What hardware and storage requirements that we would need to serve, right? And applications stored, activating also the environment on that particular system. So all these options are there to learn and understand what we need in order to fully operate our operating system. Because with Windows, it's not just that you install it and that will be it. No, there is personalization. Other than that, there is also activation of the system that is required. Until and unless you activate your system, there would be a minimum time period being given to you. If you do not do that, so any operations would be like denied to perform any operation over there. So these are the deployment options. Moving further, so that's what we discussed over here. On lesson number 4, now talking about specifically on the upgradation and migration of the Windows client environment. So in this, we will be discussing about examining the process of upgrading the Windows client, exploring some upgrade paths, examine the process of migrating the Windows client environment, common upgrade and migration considerations, that which one would be better in what cases and which one not, and at last, evaluation of these common upgrades and migration scenarios. So starting with the first part, that is examining the process of upgradation in Windows client environment. Before upgradation, we always consider whether or not do we really require the upgradation? Like taking the scenario of Windows 7 and Windows 10. In today's world, that is a necessary task, right? Because Windows 7 no longer is supporting the providing you with the support or anything with that, right? Even if it has been used, so no upgrades or upgrades now being provided in the future terms for Windows 7. So now for organizations, that has become the necessity to migrate, or if you can say that if not migrate, then to upgrade their system from Windows 7 to Windows 10 in this place. Right. So if we are doing that, there are many things that needs to be considered before performing that operation. Because it is not just moving from Windows 7 to Windows 10. There is a lot of changes in terms of services being used. The applications that were running on Windows 7, whether or not would they run on Windows 10 as well? Because version change might be the factor. Application specific, whether or not it requires or use some different services in the background to run with, there could be multiple possibilities that it may support or may not support to run on that particular platform. Even if it is the same thing, like Windows 7 to Windows 10, it's the same Windows environment, just version is being changing. But still, there could be multiple possibilities. Maybe on Windows 7, it was working on version 6. And we intendingly, like we want the application to run on version 6, but on Windows 10, it may not run on that. So we need to cross-check whether or not moving is the only option we are left with. Or if we are left with, then how this application would run on that environment. We need to consider all these factors before moving. It's not just that, okay, let's upgrade it. We need to check all these things. So evaluation is done based on all these questions that we just had. Once we are through with that, we will be backing up the existing environment. Whatever the data or the system personalizations that we have done, we will be backing up everything. And then we will be upgrading it into the environment. We will verify whether or not that everything is perfect, everything is running on the system. We will verify that if we are upgraded into that environment, Then if there is any further update into that environment, we will do that and run the applications over there. This is the process of upgrading the Windows environment. Is there any query or question in this slide, please?